look at the situation.
Well, I think it's definitely positive for them. Because of their autism, it helps give them confidence in life. They get all that feedback because people watch the show and see them in the stores or on the streets or whatever. It boosts their morale and gives them a purpose in life. Everybody has to have a purpose.
Yeah, we're both autistic and we're both high functioning. And autism is a spectrum disorder. Like, you know, see, here's the high functioning end, here's the low functioning end. I tend to be more at this end right here, at the high functioning end.
Most people look at me and they think if I'm talking normal, which I am, you know, and then there's most days here that you're just thinking like, oh my God, I'm totally, you know, scatterbrained. Oh, I forgot this, or I forgot that. It's like, it's how you do it here. It's like, It's how you, you know, try to make yourself that you're not so completely scatterbrained.
Who's menopause girls that round me outside? Round me outside, round me outside. Who's menopause girls that round me outside? Round me outside, round me outside. Guess who's back? JD's back. Talk about repeating that over and over again. Especially an instrumental break right there, too. I wouldn't know about that for sure. He might be talking about something bad in that song. Who's menopause girls around me outside? Round me outside, round me outside. Who's menopause girls around me outside? Round me outside, round me outside. 2 stars for this one.
Oh boy, you just continue to crack me up every day, don't you?
Of course. It's just for the fun of it.
Uh-huh.
I always, it's for my own enjoyment too, just seeing you go.
Hard shots at the hard liquor. Or something like that. I was talking about some liquor here.
I'd say so. Speaking of doing you laugh, I got some saliva on my glasses.
Sorry, Eminem. I'll give you an uno on this one. Because I figured if you're talking about shots at the hard liquor, that's something that's go like you must have drunk something or something. That's liquor.
The song is called Without Me, not Shots at the Hard Liquor.
Well, it did talk about it when it opened, the song, right?
Probably.
Nick has a type of autism that's called Asperger's. And it's on the very high functioning end of autism.
Nick, being autistic, does not have a lot of close friends. And Nick, it was always, here I am, world, take me as I am, which would off-put some people because they wouldn't know how to react or how to respond. There are characteristics in just the subtle social cues about what to say, how to say something, even how close you stand to a person or the type of eye contact that you make with a person, that every type of thing that we take for granted, he has to learn and remember. The big thing with autistics, the more you learn about how to deal with the social interaction between other people, then they gradually build all these different rules about how the world should function and does function, and that makes it a little better for them to integrate into society.
JB's autism is a type of autism that you can kind of control because once you teach him something, he's got it. There's no changing it back. He's got it that way, and that's the way he's going to do it.
We got one where I live right now, and he is known, everybody knows, within a 5-mile radius of where I live. In fact, as soon as I say who it is, people are going to go, oh, yeah. And that is the Sidewalk Singer. And I've actually referenced this kid on the air before. He is the happiest guy ever.
Yeah.
And no matter what happens, but this has happened to me many times where I've thought to myself, I'll bet you he's going to come around the corner. And sure enough, He comes around the corner on a bike. He's usually wearing a Lions jersey. He has headphones on.
Yeah.
He comes up to wherever I'm at, usually by the ice cream place, our very own Whippy Dip.
Right.
Parks that damn bike, gets off it, and starts singing hairband songs that he's listening to that we can't hear. It's on his headphones. Winger, Ugly Kid Joe,
okay.
Warrant,
yeah.
Bon Jovi, Motley Crue, and just starts singing. And he loves it when people engage him. And he's got a public access show, too, a TV show.
He's a real live character, public access,
and he's all over the place, man. And every time I think about him, he shows up. And I never see where he starts, just like you said, or where he finishes.
Yeah.
But he's always on that bike, and he's always singing.
Getting on in the state of Mississippi. Papa was a bubble dad, no mama was a hippie. In Alabama, she was singing. When you put the panorama, you never knew it was in them name more than now. What in the car was just coming to take me for? Like banana, sweet Louisiana, Robert Arthur in the state of Indiana. She was a where was she going? California, rest in peace. Have your tea, me, your still.
Mike, Jamie, turn your mic on.
My mic's on too, except I got a red light. Check. All right, now talk.
Hmm?
Talk.
Hmm?
Talk.
Hmm?
Talk, talk.
Mm-hmm.
Now talk.
Hmm?
Talk.
Hmm?
Talk.
Hmm?
Talk, talk.
Mm-hmm.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to this week's episode of Hot Tracks. It was a long absence for me and for JB as well, but it's really great to be back, and I'm...
Don't say as long absence, right? Nobody even knows the difference right now, so just pretend it's just another show.
All right.
Okay?
Let's start from the beginning.
Sounds good.
Hello, everyone. I'm Nick.
I'm JB. This is the show where, according to the flows, is where we rate the hits, and yes, my friends, this is definitely a brand new season for us.
The season where we've caught the spider. Season 8, to be exact. Well, of course, you know, spiders have 8 legs, so the season where we caught the spider.
With that here, hope you enjoy this season. It might be an 8th wonder of the world.
Maybe. Actually, an 8th wonder of the world,
wonder of the world.
JB, I met back in probably 94, right around there. We videotaped at Jenison High School with the autism class. It's a program called This Week in Jenison. As the years progressed, his mom noticed that he liked doing the video and being in host and talking and everything. And so she started bringing him down to the station and letting him volunteer. And then it ended up being that I'd pick him up every day that I came to work and just bring him in. And he was doing that volunteering for years and years and years before without any pay. JB and Nick both love coming here and doing the show. And Nick loves doing it. He gets so upset when he has to work and he can't come in and do the show. I mean, it's just something that he looks forward to on a weekly basis. He gets done with the show, I mean, he doesn't even go home. He hangs out here at the station. He'll go up to the restaurant and get something to eat. He'll come back here and eat it here at the station. You know he loves being here. JB and I came up with a show called Hot Tracks in the car one day. When we decided to do the show with JB, Nick was interning here, and so that's kind of where it came together. We would put both of them on the show together, and they were both into music quite a bit. They were always talking about music.
Nick and I do a show called Hot Tracks, and what we do here is where we rate the music.
Basically what it's like with Ebert and Roper in the movies. Agreeing or disagreeing, but you know, Ebert and Roper do it thumbs up, thumbs down. JB and I just do it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 stars.
What we're doing here is trying to entertain the viewers at home, you know, rather than, you know, your boring average Saturday programs or Friday nights are just going to be like, nothing's good on TV here. Like, what the heck am I watching? It's like, there's us.
I'll give a little bit of my life to that song. Same rating.
Uh-huh. If you're call yourself the Man of Steel here, which I could tell you're wearing the same, as you can tell you're wearing the S shirt with the American flag on it, tells you that you're the superhero. You got to do a lot of stuff.
Well, true, even though I am not Superman, though, but let me tell you this story, viewers. 2 years ago, when I was a sophomore, that was the second year when the football team made it to the Silver Dome. Well, we were about to leave, my dad and me, with the rest of Hudsonville fanatics. And there were a lot of people crowding around the revolving doors at the Silver Dome. And so a guy opened up the emergency exit. The Silver Dome is pressurized to keep the domes up. And once when I walked out of the emergency exit after my dad, my Superman hat suddenly flew off my head. So I went to go chase after it. And then it landed next to a guy's leg. And then he picked it up and gave it to me and said, "You lost your hat, Superman." And once when it was given to me, I said, "I'm not Superman."
Oh, so that's the legend. All because you lost your hat.
This is my trademark microphone, Mic C. Always has been and always will be. Actually, you know what? It would just make more sense to say, it always has been and it always will see, instead of always will be.
Okay, as you can tell, Nick has his trademark. This is mine. My mic's D. D is in
trademark microphone.
Trademark microphone. Thanks.
That's more, be more specific.
Right. D is kind of like a nickname, like D is a dyke, D is a dog, D is a... what?
Anything you want.
Anything I can think of, I guess. So... So it's, guess you can, say what? Heavy D?
Heavy D, huh?
Something like that, I don't know. Just a joke.
Or, Heavy D, Heavy D, Heavy D!
You know, something I could think of, you know, just... Still... This is how we get ready for the show.
When I first started watching the show and directing it, I didn't want to laugh at all because I thought it was going to hurt their feelings, or I didn't know if that was the right etiquette. But the more I watched it and the more I got to know those two, they do that for laughs. I mean, sometimes they don't, but most of the time they put a show on so you can laugh, and they watch me right back there and see if I am cracking up or not. And if I'm not, they kind of step it up a notch. I mean, I even talked to the guys a couple times after the show, like, is this okay? Should I laugh? When shouldn't I? And Nick goes, Faith, we want you to laugh.
We go together like Wayne and Garth. I mean, you know Wayne's World, right? Wayne's World, party time, excellent. I'd probably be Wayne because, don't be confused with the long hair. I'm definitely the Wayne of West Michigan, and Nick would be Garth. Everybody likes the hammer. Some people say I learned how to move like him. Anyway, moving on. Rolling Stones. 40
You think you can move like MC Hammer?
Some people think I could.
Give us a demonstration right now.
Really? Okay.
We're gonna see if you can back up your words here. If you can actually dance like MC Hammer, and okay. I want people at home to rate this.
Okay. Go for it. Go for it.
How do you?
Wrong song.
Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this. My music hits me so hard, makes me say, oh my Lord, thank you for blessing me. What am I to run and to hype? It feels good when you know you're down. A super dope homeboy from the Oak Town, and I'm known as such, and this is a beat you can't touch.
Okay, we're going to have the people at home rate to see how what they think of your dancing, and take it in stride when they criticize.
Good one. Good one. I think that's a good idea. Let me catch my breath.
Cha-cha-cha-la-choo-choo-choo.
Nick loves to have people walk up to him. He works at Myers, and he to say, "Hey, I seen you on TV last night. That was a great episode." Things like that. It just definitely boosted their morale and made them more cheerful about life, I guess you could say. And same thing with JB. People will stop him on the street and, you know, "Hey, I saw you on Hot Tracks last night." Seems like the high school kids seem to love the show quite a bit. They get a kick out of it.
Do they always want my autograph? All the time. I mean, they have always wanted my autograph from left to right, because, like I said, I'm the popular one, because, you know, no matter how far I go, it's like a rising superstar.
Nick, I don't know if it's part of his autism or not, enjoys the spotlight, and it is a good outlet for that.
There has been some public places where people have looked right at me and said, "Hey, you're that one dude from Hot Tracks." It happened at Steak and Shake. It happened when I was in college. Pretty much all around.
They definitely think they're famous. It definitely gets to their head. It definitely makes them boastful or high on themselves, I guess you could say.
Like I said, I'm the popular one, because, you know, no matter how far I go, it's like a rising superstar. You know, before the show, after the show. You know, there's always, you know, people, you know, screaming left and right, going like, "We want your autograph!" And it's like, wow, I gotta be like, so popularity. It's like, the popularity is like rushing through my brain here. It's like nothing I have ever seen before.
What happened this week before I came here? I had fans dodging left and right, wanting autographs. They think our show is pretty excellent, Nick.
That's right. Everyone loves our show.
This one's from Jeff Cannon. "You guys rule. You need to be on national television. I'm just writing this email to let you know that I have an appointment next Monday to get a tattoo of JB's face to cover my back. Keep up the great work. I will email you a picture of it when it heals." You know, at first when I read your email, Jeff, it's pretty hysterical to find out that you're going to get a tattoo of JB's face to cover your back. We'd love to see it.
Let me tell you something. And it's great to be popularity with me here. Was it Jeff? But, you know, tattoos are pretty painful, don't you think?
You
never had a tattoo on your back before? Well, believe me, it's quite painful. My brother has a huge tattoo on his back.
Oh, I thought you had. How would you know? Did you have a tattoo somewhere?
No, I don't usually wear tattoos.
I think their main goal, back when we first started, I know there was comments made that maybe MTV will pick us up. It hasn't happened. I don't think it would ever happen, but you never know. MTV's already got a show similar to it.
Dragon Force. Now I know why they got the name. Heavy metal. Cool. 5 stars.
I'm giving it 5 stars, too. That's what I call pure intensity.
Yeah, that's pure. Definitely pure.
And intense.
Oh, yeah. Definitely intense. You gotta love Dragon Force. Yes. I could see you really loving it. Dragon Force. Uh-huh. Nick's smile says it all. All right.
Plus, I'm giving you like the evil eye.
Yes, and believe me, it's working.
They want this show to go nationwide. They think by this documentary that they're going to be like famous and be put on MTV and be this big national show, and in their world, they're huge. But when it comes to the big scheme of things and the scale, they go walking down the street and nobody knows who they are.
It's here. It's not all over the country or anything like that. So the show is a local TV show, and that's where you're known. Don't think too big.
We're going to hear Blue Christmas.
Blue Christmas. Now, is that where the snowflakes turn blue?
I don't think so, but you never know.
Never know. Okay. I asked the Eagles to see if they want to do a Christmas song. They said, why not?
You did not ask the Eagles to say if they wanted to do a Christmas song.
I know that. Just follow me on this. We got an echo in both of our mics here. Just a sec here. There we go. Okay. See? I guess I pulled away from this. I don't know. The hit I'm going to be doing is Please Come Home for Christmas. It's a good hit from the Eagles.
All right. And you did not ask them if they could do a Christmas song.
You never know.
No, you didn't. You did not.
I asked Don Henley, though.
No, you didn't. You don't even know the guy.
Call me crazy, but I got a chance to talk to Don Henley before the show.
No, you did not get the chance to talk to Don Henley before the show. It was in your dream.
Yeah, anyway, got a hold of him, and he says...
No, you didn't. You did not get a hold of Don Henley in your dreams.
Uh-huh. Anyway, it was nice to have the Eagles get on and again and see if they would like to do a Christmas song.
You're going nuts here, JB.
Anyway, yeah.
Well, you quit telling them that you met with them and you met with Don Henley when you really did not. This is the Christmas special, so don't be making this up as you go along.
Of course.
Here I come to save the day. Mighty Mouse. Dungeon Dice. Now, I just randomly stumbled across this one on Craigslist.
Just had to have it, huh?
Exactly. Some guy was giving it away, and I thought, ooh, that's a cool game. But this game came out in 1977. You gotta get your prisoner out of the dungeon. You gotta roll the dice to match the symbols. Like... A match of two symbols gets you no cards. Three gets you one, four gets you two, five gets you three, and six gets you four. But you gotta watch out for those sneaky guards. Well, this is our rec room right here. Basically what it's used for, it's just for... This is my mom's sewing area right here that you see. Her sewing machine, her serger, the ironing board. She loves to sew. Now, over there are my two computers. Now, we just use that for stuff in general, like browsing the web. Basically what this is just the rec room. It's used for recreational activities. Mm-hmm. We used to have a pool table down here, and it was on this carpet where my drum set is sitting. But we disposed of that because it was getting old, and plus the covering was coming apart, the bumpers were coming off. It was an antique. But we had fun with that while it lasted. This little area right here is my dad's workshop. He uses this area to fix bikes. He used to run a bike shop. This is basically his tool bench right here.
The love you take is equal to the love.
Nice. It's really good.
Thanks.
How long have you played drums?
Well, I started in the sixth grade band. That's when I played percussion. And I was enjoying it so much. So, let's see here. Probably about 12 to 13 years I've been playing drums. Well, I'm here at Mocha and Music, you know, we're getting ready to do a ragtime gig. Chuck Brower and the Ragtime Rowdies, featuring Chuck Brower on piano, Karen Dunham on tuba, and me on drums.
Definitely is summer. You can tell by the way how warm it is outside here if you're stepping out, or if you're care to stick around and watch the rest of our 4th of July show here off Hot Tracks, then you came to the right place to cool off and, you know.
Well, hopefully you have the fans turned on and hopefully your house is air conditioning. Or maybe you just want to take a dive in your pools, you know. You have an in-ground pool at your house, if
yes,
I do say
I do,
so myself.
I do have a an in-ground pool.
But it's called Hot Tracks once they get hot and not cool.
Well, you do have a point. That is, if they tend to go outside now and, you know.
It's like Faith is adding a, it's like Faith is making a pun.
You know, being outside and it's like so muggy outside here and they're like, I'd rather stay inside and be in a nice air-conditioned house.
Well, take a dip in the pool, for Pete's sake.
Or take a dip in the pool.
Even though there are no pools inside people's houses, there are inside natatoriums.
Yeah.
And plus, you know, the director himself, Alan Dodds, he's got a pool, too.
Absolutely. It's an in-ground pool, and I'm happy with what I got.
Now, I'm a big fan of in-ground pools because they make the house look more festive.
Yeah. I mean, my house looks more festive as it is. This is our pool here, as you can clearly can tell if someone can squeeze through the fence here, but yes, this is when we first got this house, I knew the house would come with a pool, in-ground pool, so it was like, boy, we get an in-ground pool, cool. All right, as you clearly can tell here, we're standing here at this, I don't know how you want to call this, but I guess we're calling this the Wall of Fame. That's probably was me right there. Don't mind about my hair. It's kind of look like one of those typical flathead characters. As I grew older and more mature here, then came my senior year. I was still in CBI. That's CBI stands for Curricular Basic Instruction. You know, place to be independent. And that's when I got poised for taking a senior picture like that. If you're gonna go to the prom, senior prom for CBI, you gotta do it in style. Looked like for a moment I was like, kinda doing like this here, holding, leaning to a tree, like that. Kind of almost looks like I'm waiting for someone.
Were you waiting for someone?
Probably. There I am right there.
How do you think you look in that photo?
Stunning. I don't know, I still look at it to this very day and I feel like I look kind of like a dashing gentleman. Fine then. Okay, well, you pretty much seen almost everything that the house has to offer, but, beyond this door that you're about to see right now is, the most, I guess the most important, place that, you know, that anyone could really just want to escape from the ordinary life. With that being said, welcome. If I could do like a before and after for a quick second. Before, my room was ever so to be something like this now. It was blue. But then one day I said, you know, I need to change my room. I need to make this look like, you know, like I'm lost in the jungle or something. Something that's gonna say, come. Come explore. It's like you're in the jungles of safari hunt, probably somewhere in Africa, probably. Most people say I collect so many CDs here, you gotta have something. Def Leppard. I got almost every album Def Leppard has ever done, including songs from the Spargo Lounge. If I like anyone out of the country music department, it's Faith Hill. I got all three of her albums. Dire Straits. Money for Nothing. This one's another familiar. Sonic Youth. Any of you Sonic Youth fans know anything from their old albums? Gotta be a true Usher fan. When I heard Raymond vs. Raymond was coming out, I had to pick it up. Any new song that would play out, I'm the first one to get the album. After buying a couple CDs, a couple records, whatever it is you're considering now, or if there's songs I've heard on the radio, it's like, I got hooked into it, and, you know, I want it. I stick to one thing only, and that's music, and that's, oh my God, it's like, you gotta like music, and that's all there is to it.
They are amazing with the knowledge of the bands that are out there and the songs and who sings what and who plays the drums here, and you cannot stump them on anything musically. And it's just, they are a sponge when it comes to anything musically.
All right, JB, can you guess what this one is?
Okay, let's see. What do you got?
Not that one, though, but because there was a mosquito flying around. But anyway, here we go.
I know this one now. It's Alvin Lee in 10 Years After song, I'd Love to Change the World.
That's right. Oh, wait, no, wrong chord.
The Unforgiven. Nothing else matters. Metallica.
Mm-hmm. 40 off. It's like I wasn't ready for that one.
Mm-hmm. No, you're not in my house. This is Nick's house. And this is where we, once in a while, you know, yeah, I'll hang out with him. And, let's see. You know, I'm lucky to have a friend like him. Me and Nick always has loads of fun.
That's true.
Yeah,
you need to quit saying,
Sorry. Well, what we're doing today here is on a nice day like this, we're carving pumpkins. One pumpkin is going to be a character, like a jack-o'-lantern. And the other one is going to represent our show. It will be wonderful when we get it all done.
As you can see, this pumpkin is the silhouette of Rather Dashing. Now, Rather Dashing is a character from the game Peasant's Quest on homestarrunner.com. Because, of course, they use the Trogdor character that was created by Strongbad. You know, Trogdor was a man. I mean, he was a dragon man. Or maybe he was just a dragon. But he was still Trogdor! Trogdor! You know that. And the truck door comes in the night. So this is the finished product. Rather dashing off to go get revenge on Trogdor for burninating his cottage.
Nice.
Burninating the countryside, burninating the peasants, burninating all the peoples. And that's true cottages! Special cottages! Well, these are the finished pumpkins. Pista's hot tracks on it. And of course, this one's got, as you can see, and of course, this one has the character of Rather Dashing from HomestarRunner.com from the game Peasant's Quest. I'd say one looks rather dashing, and the other looks hot.
Couldn't say it better myself. Definitely. Okay, folks. Thanks for letting us be a part of your Halloween special here on Hot Tracks here. Again, let me say everybody have a safe and prosperous Halloween here.
I will say that exactly as well.
Prosperous? Are we in the new year already?
No, but everybody needs... No, we're not in the new year.
Well, then you shouldn't have said prosperous.
Sorry, I thought you said safe and joyous. I'll say that.
Have a safe Halloween.
No, we're at Christmas.
Hank... Have a safe Halloween, kids, okay. Including the parents out there who take them around trick-or-treating. We'll see you next time.
Spill on. Greetings, we're live out here in the fairground here. I'm getting filled up as the night progresses. For those of you who don't know, I usually run camera, so I'll be running a little bit of camera work for you as we get set for tonight's event.
At the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight.
And we're about ready to get started with our event tonight, which is the off-road demo derby. 3, 2, 1. This is a great year for all of us here. A lot of events going on. As you clearly can tell, one of our volunteers and my co-host of Hot Tracks, Nick Van Zennen, is out filming a magic show. What's great about the Hudsonville Fair here is, you get not only to enjoy certain events like what you're seeing, but, you get to enjoy, certain free stuff, free rides, free food, you name it, you got everything you wanted here, so, let's not forget free rides, you got free rides, so you gotta like that.
I love you. Bye.
What was,
Who was that, J.B.?
Yeah, who was that?
That was my girlfriend, or in the case in the French terms, fiancé. To Americans, yes, it is pronounced in English terms, girlfriend. The French calls it fiancé. Me and Julie have been going out since, what, high school. And to me, I feel like that's a long-term relationship. Enough of me to, that I can call her my fiancé, but, not to say that we're indecently proposed yet, and I didn't say we're not indecently married. Someone was asking me, saying if this was the perfect girl, and she is. We've done a lot of things together here, and I'm thinking she's definitely the one.
And before the song rating gets underway, I'd like to give a shout out to Natalie and Stephanie, my girls at Granville. I love you, you're awesome, you're pretty, you're cool, and you rock.
The first girlfriend I ever had, her name was Erin Hess. I met her on plentyoffish.com. And then a year later, I met Courtney. Now, Courtney may have been my second girlfriend, but she was my first serious girlfriend. I was ready to propose to her, but then that all came to a tragic halt. The whole family had to move away. And this was very hard on me. And so what happened is when she told me the news over the phone, I said some words that weren't meant to be said because I was wrapped up in my emotions. I just automatically out of the blue said, "It's not gonna work." I was devastated for quite a long time. I do miss Courtney lots and lots. I miss her kiss. I miss the dates we had together. It's just been tough. Hello there, everyone. My name is Nick Van Zanten, and I'm from Hudsonville. I like to play drums, work out daily, take pictures, bike ride, go to concerts, and I also love spending time with family and friends. I've been in two relationships, and I'm hoping to start out as friends and see how it goes from there, but I like to take my time. I love the Lord with all my heart, so if you read this ad, please send me an email. Put your favorite color in the subject line. Your picture gets mine. The reason why I don't put autism in the posting is because people would just read the ad and they would think to themselves, "Nope, he's not the one for me, I'm sorry to say." If they find out I have autism, then they don't talk to me. I've approached other girls, taken many chances, trying to see if they would hang out with me or maybe call me. All those girls I met were either had boyfriends, they were married, they were engaged, or seeing someone else. Or they just weren't interested in me, they would just run away from me. And whenever I do that, he tries to grab my fingers. But this time, since we were a length apart, I just knocked his arm down. Of course, I would have went, "Nish! Nish!"
Don't hurt him.
See? Googly googly googa.
Nish! Have a little faith.
Oh. How about this?
Do you think I look kind of an angelic glow on camera?
I think very interesting the stuff that JB and Nick can do just with the autism they have, and it's sad that, you know, some of the things they can't do or never be able to do, like drive a car or hold a job down to where they can, you know, live comfortably like you and I and raise a family.
Every young person has the American dream, which is you grow up, you have go to school, you get a job, you have a girlfriend. The next thing is to get married and have a house. The thing after that is to have a baby. I don't think that's a reality for JB.
What would you both say to someone if they were to tell you guys that you couldn't get married and live on your own? What would you say to them?
Well, it's quite a riveting challenge here indeed here. But you know, we got to accept what God has given us here, and that's the essential tools and the right kind of unique way here that's saying that, okay, God, we can live on our own. You gotta give us a chance.
And He will provide for us. Yes, He will. And you know, we're both autistic, and I've read somewhere that autistics can get married. For those people out there that say and think autistics can't get married, I think they are dead wrong.
Oh, I have a lot of them. Tell me about your fiance. Remember we asked you about your fiance?
Oh, boy, that was like the first moment I was like, good love, you know? I knew it's like, the moment I was like, I knew she'd be the one for me.
So you're telling me that you have a fiance, but you say you always get the ladies. You still get the ladies?
Hey, that's how it is with the celebrity, you know? No matter how I mean, I keep the celebrity personal thing under my hat, under the hat.
Yeah.
I mean, sure, that's the whole point of it all here, you know. I don't care if the ladies want my autograph or something. It's just that at the end of the day, and it's like, I'm finally relaxed. I just want to talk to her. I guess what I'm trying to say is, she means everything to me.
No, of course. I'm meaning, like, what's new in your life? Like, anything else you'd like to talk about?
Courtney has contacted me a couple weeks ago, and this is just after I got done shooting the show, and she randomly called me. It was just basically just to see how I was doing, and then she says to me in the conversation, I hear you've been wanting to get back together with me a couple times, is that true? And so I said, let's just leave it in God's hands and see how it goes from there. And then she says, well, I thought about you a couple times. I told her, I thought about you too. They say there's a slight possibility that they might move back because they're not adjusting well down there. I'd be really happy if they did move back. I feel like Courtney is the one for me because, you know, I really loved her lots and she really loved me. I would really like for her and me to get back together as boyfriend and girlfriend and maybe date for a certain amount of months, and maybe it could possibly lead into marriage. Because that's the one thing I want in my life, is I want to get married. I want to start a family. This is another photo of me and her when we were at Spring Grove Park.
Miss those times?
Oh, yeah. Oh, Courtney, the good times we shared. I've loved you with all my heart. I still can't believe that you're gone. I miss you so much.
We try to be like other people, like, you know, like we want to impress others. You know, we want to try to impress others to make them attracted to us. But, you know, it doesn't work that way. And yet, you know, we got to think to ourselves, and we got to turn around saying, no, this is not the direction I'm supposed to go. I just want to be myself. And as I do recall, I remember a conversation I had with you once, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Your brothers both have tattoos, and you're the only one that doesn't. And I asked you, why is that? And you said a really good answer that made perfect sense. You said, because I just want to be me.
And I still want to. It's like, you know, they can do whatever they want. They can get tattoos, and they can be cool, and they can be whatever they want to be. Me, I just rather just be myself.
Hot Tracks. This little half-hour show has changed the lives of these two guys. That means the world to them. And even if nobody watches, it doesn't matter.
It gives him a real creative outlet. And all the knowledge that he has of bands and music can really be expressed in that show.
JB and Nick need a way to open up to the public and to themselves and express their feelings, inner feelings, and it just helps them all the way around.
It gives him such confidence and such joy to be able to know that people accept them for who Nick and JB are.
We have done the show for a decade now. After when the show is done, I'd like people to remember me and JB.
We're still gonna be here, 10 years. Like I said, in 10 years time, we're still gonna do the show. Keep going with the show, make it as it is. Be, be popular. If someone asked you, what would you do when you die, if someone asked me what would happen to me if I die, or what would have been my greatest memory, is making a mark here and doing the show that we all love, the show that's gonna, you know, say, like, I'm willing to give the torch to another person, someone like me.